I'm not sure it's true, by the way, because, of course, in medicine you also have a lot of things like human biology or internal medicine or something, which can be very complicated, like whatever you want, so or chemistry or whatever. So, but of course, it's true that several applications lend themselves more natural to problem-oriented teaching than others. That's obvious. Several fields. With medicine, you had a big difference. We learned the hard way with economics, because we started, of course, to copy the medicine system, because there was nothing else, which was taken, by the way, from Canada, from McMaster University. And so we started to copy one by one the medicine system. What was characteristic of the medicine system? The patient enters the doctor's office, and he or she has a problem, and she tells about the problem, and the doctor has to decide what the hell is going on. So you have a problem, and you start to talk about it, think about it, and analyze it. So it was really problem-oriented, and we started also out that way. However, we discovered, first of all, that our textbooks are not written that way. Our textbooks are written very linear: microeconomics, macroeconomics, strategy and organization, marketing, whatever. So if you go to the literature, you will always find these very, very typical textbooks which you should use. We were also not used to think in those ways. We were not doctors, so we didn't have patients entering our office saying, "I have a problem," but we were a different kind of persons, and we also had a different background in that respect, so we were not working in that sense in problem-oriented fields, although later on people in practice can be problem-oriented, but less natural than doctors, I would say. Third, and that's quite important to realize, in medicine you only have one doctoral exam and only one field. You become a doctor of medicine, period, and there are no majors or something like that. You simply do everybody does the same. So if after year one you start to do either economics or business economics, that's already a complication. And if after year two you start to do within business economics or economics other things, so we had already a very big field of many things which we should cover. Because what you should realize that an integral element of the true problem-oriented teaching is a final exam, which is done by everybody in the same way. I'm not sure Randwick still has it, but it's called the Voortgangsexamen, the progress exam. And the idea behind it is that there is a certain body of knowledge a doctor should cover. You can define that body of knowledge, and you can ask it at every level, because at the end, he or she should cover it. Let's say for 80%. But you should not be surprised that in year three, the person only covers it for 60%. And in year two, only for 40%. And in year one, only for 20%. But that doesn't matter. It can still be the same exam. So everybody does, in that philosophy, the same exam. And then it also is not very bad if one student starts to look more at this direction and the other student starts to look more at that direction, because in the end, all directions will be covered, and in the meantime, one student can get his 20% in that direction, and the other student can get his 20% in that direction. So in that sense, the problem-oriented teaching can go in many directions. The discussions in the groups can go in many directions without harming this notion of progress over time. Well, you see already that if you look at our system and our aims, that you get a totally different story. And we could not afford that. So we could not have all these discussions going in all directions. So we had to be more consistent in our teaching. And that was a very big hurdle, how to do that. Plus the fact that the students immediately realized, oh, this is a marketing problem, so we should look at that textbook. And this is a macroeconomics problem. So imagine that you have macroeconomics, strategy, and marketing in one course manual. I still have the course manual, 1.6 it's called. It was the course manual before summer. And we had staff members who never communicated with each other before, think about strategy, microeconomics and marketing and somehow mix that in one block in 6 weeks. It was 6 weeks then, six times 6 weeks. And try to make something sensible out of that. A. B, it should be also consistent with what was in the textbooks, because we wanted to have textbooks in the background, of course. Well, of course, but that's what we wanted. Well, that was really very, very difficult. So the first generation was raised in a rather interesting way, let me put it that way. The first generation, for instance, consists of persons like Christian Kerkhoffs. He was one of the first 100. Huub Meijers, Bart Verspagen. So these kind of guys, they were raised that way, and they encountered all these problems as students.